Hi all, I'm Honey Mommers of Age with Care, and today's interview is together with Ellen de Dreux. I have followed Ellen for quite some while now, and I admire her immensely for her courageousness and her plans and things like that. I'll let you introduce yourself later on, Ellen, but my first question is always, what do you think when you hear age with care? What are your thoughts about aging and caring?
Well, for me, the most important thing is that no matter what you age, you always follow your intuition, what you really want to do. Because most people think that health and freedom and so on is all in the outside world, like you're healthy if you don't have to go to a doctor, or you have freedom when you have lots of money. But I've been traveling now for 5 years. I've been a digital nomad. And I mean, it is the optimum of freedom, you know, and I became a digital nomad when I was 48. And I was traveling in a Volkswagen camper van, and people thought, hey, this is freedom, or this is, you know, like health. But for me, the most important thing that it's really that you do what you want to do most. Because if you do this, then health will follow. And it's more scary or difficult than you think, because we have so many distractions and so many people and voices in our head saying you shouldn't be doing what you really want to do because it's scary, because what would other people think? Or, you know, there are so many dragons, I call them dragons in your head, that keep you from doing what you really want to do most. But if you do this, then age is irrelevant. I actually, people said to me, you look younger, you know, after I started traveling. I'm 52 now, but and I'm a digital nomad, and most digital nomads are younger than me. But it's not important, because I really, every day, I try to listen within, like, what is important to me? What is it I want to do today? What is it I want to do in my life? What is... And of course, all the fear shows up. I have them every day. But for me, it's the most important thing to be conscious of them and to do it anyway. And the most, maybe if it, this is the positive formulation, and the negative formulation is like, if you imagine and you're on your deathbed, what is it that you would regret not doing? You know, like you earned all this money, you've been working so long, you think, I wish I should have done this. You do not want to die like this, you know. You, no matter what age you are,
it's usually what they say. Are you regretting spending so much time in an office when you're on your deathbed?
Yeah.
It won't happen. You will probably think something else.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't think that's a such a negative point of view, because no. I think it's important to also think about death, because the end is coming for all of us. That's the only certainty that we have. So
And what is so for me, it's sad. I meet so many women, and they want to start an online program, or they want to make a business, and they say, hey, but I'm already 63 or I'm 70, and is it a problem? And for me, I think, well, it's the best age, because you've learned so much, and now you can share your knowledge with the world. And then these people have this limiting idea that I'm already 70. And this is, of course, in our society, when youth is like the, you know, the best thing. But I think that really, like, if you grow older, you learn so much and you can share your wisdom with other people. I mean, you're the best age actually to become a digital nomad, like you living in Spain. Why not?
Yeah, I don't consider myself a digital nomad at the moment.
No.
Because I'm not traveling anymore. But when I was traveling for a year, not so long ago, I said as well that I was a digital nomad. And
good for you. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's what you say. Society limits us by having these thoughts about how you should act if you're aging. And yeah. It's great that you say, well, it doesn't matter because you just have to do what you feel yeah. like.
Yeah. So, yeah, and especially also for women, because we have two limitations, like you have age and then also, I mean, my mother, when she married, she had to stop working. So I'm actually the first generation of women historically who can become a digital nomad and travel and build my own business and become successful. But there are also lots of limitations. And what I like about Spain is that Spain has a different culture about women. I mean, older women are also strong women, you know. So, yes, they have their business and there's a difference. In the Netherlands, it's a bit different. But I like Spain also for this, for the strong women who, mm-hmm. like also in the flamenco, no? You really, the strong temperamental women, also older women. It's different. I like this.
Yeah. I only partly agree with you on that regard, because a lot of women have to work when they are living in Spain, yes. but they also have to do all the cooking and have to take care yes. of the children. And I don't see many men doing that as well, because no. it's two sides. It's
yeah,
not
that's true.
Women, but what do yeah. the men do?
Yeah, it's also patriarchy. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Yeah. No. But anyway, I totally agree that Spain is a great country to live in. So, Ellen, could you tell us in short a little bit where you come from? Not just that you are Dutch like me, but
no.
your past has been.
I went to university in Utrecht, and when I graduated, I wanted to work at the university as a researcher, but there was no money, so I became a teacher. And then, funny thing happened, I got a teaching job for only 6 hours, so I really needed another income because I really wanted to do the teaching. But I didn't have any education becoming a teacher, but I just said, yeah, like, I want to do this, I'm going to do it. But I needed another income, and then friends of mine came along and said, hey, there's a small restaurant. You could do this. And I did this for 9 years. And the first year, this restaurant was really small and I could do it alone. And we're like 10 places. And it was really simple. But the next year, I had a really full-grown restaurant with 8 people working for me and 80 seats. And I was the cook. And I also didn't know how to run a restaurant. I just did it. And I just made a lot of mistakes and learned how to do this. And it was in the north of the Netherlands, in a lake district with a lot of boats, and my restaurant was in a harbor, and it was the job that they had that earned the least money, but I had the most fun, because people would come like the CEO of a hospital, but also local farmer boys, and they would become friends in my bar, you know. And I was really like the mother hen, taking them all under my wing, and children and dogs, and we had, so I mean, this was a lot of work, but it was really fun. And I did this for 9 years, but at the end, my husband and I, we had a really big house also there, and this is really paradise for me, like a big farmer's house, and we had a lot of animals. But he became ill, he had a psychiatric disorder, and this was really like really difficult period. Like for 3 years, I had the bar, I had my job, and a husband who needed care. And after 3 years, when the doctor said, you're better, I left, because I had to save myself. I was really exhausted, and you know, the love ended also in this period.
Yeah.
And I basically lost everything I had. So I was like 40, and I didn't have a house. I lost I had to sell my business. I lost all my animals also, of course, because I had to leave the house. And then I also lost my job because the university ran out of money. Mm. And this was like spiritually the best year ever because I lost everything. So, you know, it's life decided that I had to start again.
Oh, yeah.
And I learned a lot of lessons in this year. And then the biggest what I've learned is that I was also, I mean, I was a victim because of what happened to my husband. But when I said I was also a part in it. And when I took responsibility for my part in everything that happened, I decided that if I could make myself unhappy, I can also make myself happy. And this was the day that I really, this was like really a terrible day, because I realized that I was responsible also for my own unhappiness.
Yeah.
But I, at the end of the day, I thought, I'm also responsible for my own happiness. And then I just started over. And I thought, I remember this really, like, I have the chance to do everything over again. I don't have any attachments. So it's really easy to really think, like, what is it I want to do until I grow old?
Yeah.
And I invested the money I had from the sale of the house into a trainer education, and I learned a lot about marketing. And within a few years, I built my own trainer company, and I earned a lot of money. Like, I worked like crazy, and it was also a bit like, I proved to you that I'm worth it, you know, like from scratch to like six-figure business in yeah. 1.5 years, you know, like really, yeah, it really was amazing. And then I lived the dream. I had all this money and I had it in my bank, and I thought, now what? You know, I was again a really spiritually good year, because I found out that it wasn't important to me, this money. So I went, and then in the beginning of 2015, I suddenly decided to go traveling in my camper van, because really easy, when I was at home, I was unhappy. When I was traveling in my camper van, I was happy. Mm-hmm. So I just followed the bliss. And I decided at the beginning of January that I would leave three weeks later, and I did. So 3 weeks later, I drove out of the country with my business under my arm, and I was terrified. It's the most difficult thing I've ever done, because I lost everything again, like my house and friends and stability and routine. You know, I gave it all up, but now I did it myself.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really a hard decision. But then the first 3 weeks were terrible, like with snow and ice. And I was like, what am I doing? Why am I going? And I was like, so terrified. But then I started a journey of 2.5 years all over Europe in a really old camper van that broke down all the time. And I had to, I have many car mechanics all over Europe who have really become good friends, you know.
There are many garages now.
Yeah. And I changed my own flat tire. Like, I'm really proud of myself. And after 2.5 years, I was sick. I was tired of traveling, and a house found me. I was in Tarifa, which is now home to me. It's in the south of Spain. Really, you're almost in Morocco, you know, probably. But
yeah,
I lived there for 9 months in a nature reserve, and for me, that was paradise. It was near a really nice town, and I had a dog, and I went to the beach every day. And there I wrote a book about my journey, which is called Ellen in Wonderland. But I wrote a first chapter about my life before the journey, like my marriage, but then also my youth. And then both were not happy. So this was the Pandora box opened, you know, like, and it's, you know, it hit me. And I said to it, okay, I'm going to heal. I really, because I also became physically ill. And I said, if I want to heal, I have to face these dragons. These, you know, I pushed them away for a long time because I didn't have time to look at them, or I didn't want to, or I didn't have the courage. And I said, yes, I'm going to look at them. And I spent 2.5 years, like, alone in nature, basically, in the Netherlands, because I couldn't get any professional help that really was helpful to me. So I lived alone in nature and just waited and just walked in nature and let nature heal me. And until December, last December, I decided I'm done. I'm healed. I'm, you know, light went on. And I healed physically, I healed mentally. And now I decided I want to start a new journey. And I went back to Spain, because Spain for me is home. I like the energy here. I like that people are so much more alive.
The sun.
Yeah, the sun also, but it's not so important. A lot of I like spending winter in the Netherlands, especially the autumn with the trees, and I really like it. But the energy, I like that the people in Spain, when you go out on the street, people are playing the guitar and singing and going out together. And in the Netherlands, everyone is in their own home, you know, like we have. If I invite them in the Netherlands for a party, they said, well, we don't have time and we already have friends, so we don't want to meet new people. And, you know, it's all really organized. And on the other hand, in Spain, it's like, hey, you want to go out? Yeah, of course, I invite my friends as well. And then before you know it, you're like with 20 different people from 30 different countries doing nice things. And that's what I like.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. If I understand you correctly, your setbacks, what you call dragons, came because of your writing process, or did I understand that? Okay.
Yeah.
So I guess you had more dragons, because if you're a solo traveler and if you're a digital nomad, you must have had a lot of them. So how did you deal with that, or how do you deal with that?
Well, for me, traveling alone in a camper van all over Europe, for me, is much safer than in being in an environment that looks like a family. You know, it's really. If I'm in a group and if group gets, you know, I feel I'm stuck. I really feel suffocated because of my youth. You know, it's I really have to go. There should be an escape somewhere. But for me, meeting new people, traveling in nature, I mean, people are really nice. In 2.5 years of traveling alone in my camper van, I only met nice people, really helpful people, amazing. You know what strangers do if you ask them a question, and the connection you make to new people, because they don't know your history, they just, you know, they see what they get, and you start connecting, and especially traveling in nature. I mean, people who like nature are kind people. So when I'm there with my binoculars and I meet other people with binoculars, we're friends. You know, it's that easy. And
we speak your languages, so it's more easy to get in contact with others.
Yeah, and it's so funny, because also in the Netherlands, I was living in a caravan in nature, in a wood, and it was really dark. And most people said, aren't you afraid? You know, like being alone in the dark is like, this is what society tells us. You should be afraid when you're alone in nature.
Yeah.
Well, for me, and then my reply is, but most women die because they're killed by their husbands or their ex-husbands. You know, the mortality rate of women is the highest at home, around surrounded by people they know.
Yeah,
but this is not what gets into the newspapers. What is in a newspaper is if a woman walks somewhere alone in nature and she gets raped and killed, which is awful. But the chance of that happening is so small. It's one in, I don't know. But at the same time, the amount of violence what happens at home is so much more. So for me, it's like, and for me, traveling alone is so interesting, because you have the chance to reflect on your thoughts, like, what am I thinking? And this is really true.
Yeah.
And I had a camper van with a bicycle on it. And everywhere I went, I would go on my bicycle, also in nature reserves. And sometimes I would be like there at night. And one time I was going from Tarifa back to the campsite, and it was 4 kilometers through a really dark nature reserve, and I was like, oh, but it's so nice because it's so dark and I can see the moon. And then I realized most people would think, oh, it's so dark, I'm scared.
Yeah,
but
it's a perception,
becoming conscious of your thoughts and if they're true, or is it something that others told you that you should be afraid of?
Yeah, good of you. You always say you have to live from trust and not from fear. So that's what you explained now.
Yeah.
It's a really interesting process that you went through, because the thoughts that are implanted in our heads, they can be so loud.
Yes, really loud.
So do you have tips how you have explained a little bit already, but I'm just wondering,
yes,
how do you
I have two tips. And the first thing is that if your fear is so loud, it's actually a good sign in my book, because your fear, imagine your fear, like dragons living in your head, and you have a heart which is filled with dreams and longings, and you want to do something, and it's happening at the same time, which is makes it really complicated. Yeah. But if this longing or what you want to do in your heart is really important, then your dragons get loud, because they think, oh, this is transformation, and they have to shout harder, louder, if it's more important. Because if it's not so important, they say, well, yeah, you go ahead, you know, go. But if it's really important to you, then it gets really scary and vulnerable. And sharing my ideas, also it's vulnerable, because it's mine. And then these fears come up, like other people are going to steal it, or they're going to reject you. You know, this is one of my biggest fears. But then the first tip is, like, if this is really loud, pay attention, because then it is important. Mm. And you actually should do it. Like, I knew when I went traveling in my camper van, I was so afraid. There was one point I couldn't walk. My knees were literally wobbling. And I thought, this is a good sign. I'm terrified, but I'm going to do it anyway, because it means that it's important. So this is one tip. And the other tip is, it's listening to your fears. Don't push them away. It's like feeling it. Because if you push it away, it gets bigger. But if you feel the fear, and then consciously decide to do it anyway, to live from trust. And it's really hard, because the fear is so loud, but you have a choice. You always have a choice.
Yeah.
I always imagine it like, ooh, two hands. Where are my hands? Yeah. I'm in reverse. So, but we have two hands, and one of them is filled with fear and the other one with trust. And you can actually choose which one you follow.
Yeah.
And the fear is there. The fear is always there. But it's for me also as well. I mean, sometimes I was traveling in my camper van and I had to replace my flat tire in Extremadura, which is really empty country, and it was hot. And, you know, and then I arrived at the campsite, and it was a holiday. So all the Spanish people were in groups, and I was the only one who was alone, and they were looking at me. And of course, I'm scared. But it's just, I can say, okay, I'm scared, I'm going home. Or you can say, I'm scared. Yeah, so what?
I do it anyway.
And then do it anyway.
Yeah. And you were hinting on your plans. You had a very good Facebook Live yesterday on your timeline. So you shared a little bit about your plans. And yeah. I got enthusiastic together with you, because it's really great.
Yeah. Can I share it again?
If you want to, because...
Yeah, because this is also really interesting for people like over 60. A lot of them go in a camper van and they go traveling. And the biggest problem for a lot of people is how to build a community. Because if you're home, you have your friends and you have your activities and you meet people. But if you go traveling, or if you immigrate to another country, how to build a community. And especially traveling in a camper van, it's really hard. And I had some places that I would always come back to. But like, if you're a digital nomad, you could also look for a co-working place, and then you meet other digital nomads also working remote, and you would talk together. But I don't go in a camper van in a city. So I made a plan, and it's like, this, yeah. And I want to have a house, rent a house with more people, and I want to do a co-working space, but in nature. So people can come with their camper vans. This is really funny, like I'm right, left. The camper vans, and they can come in the garden, and stay and work together. But in this house, I'm always also going to invite artists and locals. And what we do is we eat together and do workshops and share food and share ideas and maybe make plans to make the world a better place. You know, I want to really like co-working, co-living, co-creating.
Yeah.
And like if artists are creating, they create art. But when I help my clients build a business, it's also a creative process. And you can actually learn from each other. And what for me is also really important, I also want to invite locals because I want to give something back to the community. But what really is important, when I was living in Tarifa, I had a garden and a tree, and every two Saturdays I would do a party, a tertulia, where I would invite all my friends and to bring their friends. So we would have kite surfers and yoga teachers and digital nomads and locals. And for me, the best part of this party was meeting people you would normally not meet. Because normally you meet the people who are just like you. And it's really important to meet like-minded people. But for me, life gets better if you also interact with people who do something really different. Like if you co-create with artists, their process is different and you can learn from each other. And then they can help you and you can help them. And then afterwards you go to eat together and you also have fun, you know? Like,
yeah.
This is also why Spain is so good. I mean, you would sit for hours on Sunday lunch and the Dutch would like half an hour later, like, no, let's do something. And Spanish, no, it's Sunday and we have lunch, you know, it takes hours. And this is for me a place, this is what I wanted to create. And I want to invite other people, like for your audience, please, if there's someone somewhere in Europe who has a garden and a house or money or don't know, and also want to create something like this, we can then connect them in an online community. And so if you're a nomad or you just want to, you know, like leave house for a while, you can come to one of these places, but you can also go to Ireland and you already know who's there because you've met them online.
Yeah.
And I want to make this like one big community of co-working spaces in nature where you can come and you can go. And maybe sometimes people come for a few months or a few weeks and then leave again and come back. So it's a kind of, especially also for older people, like co-living, co-working, having a community.
I became so enthusiastic. To be honest, I think it's an idea worth stealing.
A lot of people
do that and then connect.
Yes, this is one idea. Normally, I would have an idea in my business and I would keep it close to my chest. Like if they steal it, and this I just shared. Please steal this idea. You know, like please take it, and then start something, and then we co-create and we connect all these places. It can only get better.
Yeah, it's really great. The time is flying, Ellen. I had some more questions.
I'm sorry, my answers were so long,
But I try always to restrict it to about half an hour. I do want to show your connectability. So this is your website. Where people can go to. I'll post them later in the description box as well. So then they only have to click because that's obviously not possible from a video.
Can I say one thing about this?
Yes.
Try to keep it short. My co-working idea is my personal dream, but it connects to my website because I help, I'm a business coach. I help entrepreneurs build a business in which I have maximum freedom, but financial freedom, but also inner freedom, and also the personal freedom to make it location independent so you can work where you want. Like you can, like if you live in Spain, you can build an online program and you can get your clients come online from the Netherlands and you can be wherever you want to be all over the world and you can, and I'm really good at helping them build such a business. But then for me, what is really important, it's like building the business and a strategy and how you make such a program. But it's also especially that you have the confidence and that you find joy in it, and it's not becoming stress, and that you follow your intuition. So a strategy and intuition both.
Yeah.
And creativity and you know, it's I always connect it from, you start within, what is you really want to do, and then you create it, and then you go within again, and then it's this circle. Because as I told you a few years ago, I made a lot of money and I wasn't happy. Mm-hmm. So this is what I want to prevent, that people make a lot of money or become a digital nomad, or, you know, have financial freedom, but really also have this inner freedom, that they really follow the intuition and they're confident and they feel it on the inside, and it's better.
Exactly. And if my audience is watching this and are thinking, well, I don't work, still the inner freedom and the freedom to choose is important.
Yeah, and do it from trust and not from fear. Like, this is what it's like freedom and trust and connection. These are my three major interest points. And I've learned so much about it, and I help them. Also with the dragons, overcoming fear, especially this.
Yeah, really good. I want to show your Facebook address as well, because people can connect there also. And there is your Facebook Live of yesterday, which I really recommend watching, because you have shown a little bit about it now, but that Facebook Live is a little bit more extended. Yeah. So, it got me very enthusiastic.
Oh, I'm happy. Yeah, it's already there. Only have to build it.
Yeah. So, Ellen, thank you so much. I really love talking to you. And take care. And I keep my fingers crossed that your plans, well, I'm sure they will come true.
And you come and you come live a while, and then we do more like these Facebook Lives, like every day. And then we share all our wisdom and invite everyone to come. And it's going to be one big party. I can't wait.
Images in front of me.
Yes.
It's so great. Okay, thank you very much. If you are watching this in the replay, will you please comment hashtag replay, so we know who has been watching, and give us a lot of hearts so this message gets spread, because it's important. Okay, thank you. Bye.
Bye.